Macmillan Audio presents Midnight Rising, John Brown and the Raid That Sparked the Civil War by Tony Horwitz. Read for you by Daniel Oreskes. Sometimes there comes a crack in time itself. Sometimes the earth is torn by something blind. Stephen Vincent Benet, John Brown's Body. Prologue, October 16th, 1859.
Men, get on your arms, the captain said. We will proceed to the ferry.
It was 8 at night, an autumn Sunday, silent and dark in the Maryland hills. A horse-drawn wagon pulled up to the log house, and the men loaded it with pikes, tools, torches, and gunpowder. The captain put on the battered cap he'd worn in Bleeding Kansas. Then he climbed on the wagon, and the men marched behind, down a dirt lane, past a snake rail fence, onto the road to Harper's Ferry. There were 18 men, not counting the captain. Almost all were in their 20s, and had written farewell letters to family and lovers. 5 of them were black, including a fugitive slave and a freedman whose wife and children were still in bondage. 2 others were the captain's sons. All had been formally inducted at the secluded log house as soldiers in the Provisional Army of the United States. Their commander was 59, a sinewy man with gunmetal eyes and a white beard he'd grown to conceal his identity. He was wanted by state and federal authorities. President Buchanan had put a price on his head. While living underground, the captain had drafted a constitution and a declaration of liberty for the revolutionary government that tonight's action would found. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for an oppressed people to rise and assert their natural rights, the declaration began. If the opening sounded familiar, the close was not. We will obtain these rights or die in the struggle, the document stated before concluding, hung be the heavens in scarlet. The road ran below a mountain ridge, through woods and rolling farmland. The mid-October night was cool and drizzly and dark, perfect weather for a surprise attack. There was no one else abroad and no sound, just the creak of the wagon's wooden wheels and the clop of hooves. Steam rose from the horse's flanks. Behind the captain's wagon, the men marched in pairs, solemn and speechless, as if in a funeral cortege. Their orders were to make no noise and to conceal their rifles beneath gray shawls. Anyone they encountered was to be detained. After 3 miles, the road descended steeply to the wide, swift Potomac River. On the far bank glowed the gas lamps of Harper's Ferry, Virginia, a factory town, and the gateway to the largest slave state in the country. 2 of the men crept ahead. Soon they would cut the telegraph lines linking Harper's Ferry to the outside world. 2 other men, hard veterans of Kansas, slipped onto the covered bridge over the Potomac and seized the night watchman who trolled back and forth with a lantern. The captain followed in his wagon, leading the others across the bridge. It was an hour before midnight when they emerged on the Virginia shore and entered the business district of Harper's Ferry. The wagon clattered across pavement, past a rail depot, a hotel, saloons, and shops, and up to the front gate of the U.S. Armory. Behind its high wrought iron fence stretched a massive industrial complex where the nation's newest weapons were manufactured.
Open the gate,
one of the men shouted at a night guard within the armory fence. The watchman refused. 2 of the men grabbed hold of him through the fence and pressed guns to his chest. Another man forced the gate's lock with a crowbar. Then the captain rode into the armory yard and took the watchman prisoner.
I came here from Kansas, he announced to his captive. This is a slave state. I want to free all the Negroes in this state. I have possession now of the United States Armory, and if the citizens interfere with me, I must only burn the town and have blood.
On October 16th, 2009, I retraced the captain's march with other pilgrims who had gathered for the 150th anniversary of John Brown's famous raid on Harper's Ferry. The night was appropriately cold and wet, and we followed a horse-drawn wagon through a landscape that has changed remarkably little since 1859. Brown's log hideout in Maryland still stands, as does the armory building in Harper's Ferry that became his headquarters and fort. Though we didn't carry guns or wear 19th-century attire, I experienced a little of the time travel high that Civil War reenactors call a period rush. But walking in the footsteps of history isn't the same as being there. Even hardcore reenactors shoot blanks, not live ammunition. I could tread where Brown's men did, glimpse some of what they saw, but the place I wanted to be was inside their heads. What led them to launch a brazen assault on their own government and countrymen? Why were millions of other Americans willing to kill and die in the Civil War that followed? How did one event connect to the other? My son's ninth grade American history textbook offers little more insight than mine did in the 1970s. Harper's Ferry merits six paragraphs, a speed bump for students racing ahead to Fort Sumter and the Gettysburg Address. Recent history also provides a simplistic guide at best. Viewed through the lens of 9/11, Harper's Ferry seems an Al-Qaeda prequel. A long-bearded fundamentalist consumed by hatred of the U.S. government launches 19 men in a suicidal strike on a symbol of American power. A shocked nation plunges into war. We are still grappling with the consequences. But John Brown wasn't a charismatic foreigner crusading from half a world away. He descended from Puritans and revolutionary soldiers and believed he was fulfilling their struggle for freedom. Nor was he an alienated loner in the mold of recent homegrown terrorists such as Ted Kaczynski and Timothy McVeigh. Brown plotted while raising an enormous family. He also drew support from leading thinkers and activists of his day, including Frederick Douglass, Harriet Tubman, and Henry David Thoreau. The covert group that funneled him money and guns, the so-called Secret Six, was composed of Northern magnates and prominent Harvard men, two of them ministers. Those who followed Brown into battle represented a cross-section of mid-19th century America. In Kansas and later Virginia, he was joined by farm laborers, factory workers, tradesmen, teachers, an immigrant Jewish shopkeeper, a free black schooled at Oberlin, and two young women who acted as lookouts and camouflage at his hideout near Harper's Ferry. These foot soldiers often bristled at his leadership and rejected his orthodox Calvinism. Most who went with him to Harper's Ferry regarded themselves as non-believing infidels. Yet follow him they did, swearing allegiance to his revolutionary government and marching into Virginia to found a new order. Within 2 years, entire armies would cross the Potomac, and this obscured the magnitude of what happened in 1859. The street violence at Harper's Ferry came to seem almost quaint by comparison with the industrial-scale slaughter at Antietam and Gettysburg. In time, the uprising became known as John Brown's Raid, a minor-sounding affair like one man's act of banditry. But no one saw it that way at the time. A month after the attack, under the headline, "How would it figure in history?" a Baltimore newspaper listed the many labels given to the recent violence in Virginia. The most common were insurrection, rebellion, uprising, and invasion. Further down the list appeared war, treason, and crusade. There were 26 terms in all. Raid was not among them. The United States in the late 1850s was a divided but peaceful country, with a standing army of only 15,000 men and a booming cotton trade that fed northern mills and accounted for 3/4 of the country's export. Acts of political violence were rare. No president had yet been assassinated. The 100,000 guns at Harper's Ferry were virtually unguarded, and the long simmering conflict over slavery played out principally in Washington, where Southerners had held sway for most of the nation's history. Though many Americans hated slavery, very few sought its abolition or expected the institution to disappear anytime soon. I do not suppose,
that in the most peaceful way, ultimate extinction would occur in less than 100 years at the least, Abraham Lincoln said in 1858. He advocated resettling free blacks in Africa and pledged to leave slavery alone in the states where it existed. Harper's Ferry helped propel Lincoln into the White House, where he would ultimately fulfill Brown's mission. The Midnight Rising in Virginia also embroiled a host of future Confederates. Robert E. Lee and J.E.B. Stuart led troops against Brown. Thomas Stonewall Jackson guarded the abolitionist. So did John Wilkes Booth, who loathed Brown but took inspiration from his daring act of violence. Meanwhile, in Congress, Jefferson Davis cited the attack as grounds for Southerners to leave the Union, even if it rushes us into a sea of blood. Harper's Ferry wasn't simply a prelude to secession and civil war. In many respects, it was a dress rehearsal. This was true not only for participants, but for the millions of Americans who followed the crisis from afar through telegraphic dispatches that made Harper's Ferry one of the first breaking news stories in the nation. The debate and division stirred by the crisis unsettled decades of compromise and prevarication. On the subject of John Brown, there was no middle ground. North and South, citizens picked sides and braced for conflict that now seemed inevitable. William Lloyd Garrison, America's leading abolitionist in the decades before the Civil War, had for 30 years waged an often lonely crusade to mobilize the moral force of the nation against slavery. As an ardent pacifist, he condemned Brown's violent act. But the passion and ruptures laid bare by Harper's Ferry compelled him to reconsider. In firing his gun, he has merely told us what time of day it is, Garrison said of Brown. It is high noon, thank God. Part 1. The Row to Harper's Ferry. He was a stone eroded to a cutting edge by obstinacy, failure, and cold prayers. Stephen Vincent Benet, John Brown's Body. Chapter 1. School of Adversity. John Brown was born with the 19th century and didn't launch his attack on Virginia until he was nearly 60. But almost from birth, he was marked in ways that would set him on the long road to rebellion at Harper's Ferry. Brown was named for his grandfather, a Connecticut farmer and Revolutionary War officer who marched off to fight the British in 1776. Captain John Brown died of dysentery a few weeks later in a New York barn, leaving behind a pregnant widow and 10 children. One of them was 5-year-old Owen, who later wrote, "For want of help, we lost our crops and then our cattle, and so became poor." Owen was forced to live abroad with neighbors and nearby relations and went to work young, farming in summer and making shoes in winter. As a teenager, he found religion and met a minister's daughter, Ruth Mills, pious and frugal like himself. Soon after their marriage, Ruth gave birth to a very thrifty, forward child, a son who died before turning 2. The Browns moved to a clapboard salt box in the stony hills of Torrington, Connecticut, and had another son. In 1800, May 9th, John was born, Owen wrote. Nothing very uncommon. A portrait of Owen Brown in later years depicts a thin-lipped, hawk-beaked man with penetrating eyes, an antique version of his famous son. Owen also bestowed on John his austere Calvinism, a faith ever vigilant against sin and undue attachment to the things of this world. In his late 70s, after rising from childhood penury to become a prosperous landowner and respected civic leader, he was known in Ohio as Squire Brown. Owen wrote a brief autobiography for his family. It began, "My life has been of but little worth, mostly filled up with vanity." John Brown also wrote a short autobiography, in his Case for a Young Admirer. 2 years before the uprising at Harper's Ferry, while seeking money and guns for his campaign, he dined at the home of George Luther Stearns, a wealthy Massachusetts industrialist. Stearns' 12-year-old son Henry was inspired by Brown's anti-slavery fervor and donated his pocket money, 30 cents, to the cause. In return,
After some prodding from Stearns Sr., Brown wrote Henry a long letter describing his own youth in the early 1800s. The letter was didactic in tone, doubtless intended to impress Henry's wealthy father as much as the boy himself, but it was nonetheless a telling account, delivered in the direct, emphatic, and grammatically irregular voice that distinguishes so much of Brown's speech and writing. "I cannot tell you of anything in the first 4 years of John's life worth mentioning," Brown wrote, narrating his story in the third.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.